Okay, so I'm also trying to like broadcast this on Facebook Live, but I don't know if it's happening or not. I hope it's happening. I'll find out, because people will be like showing up on the sidebar or something. So the paper or like the ideas I'm presenting to you are still in a raw form, and hopefully by getting some feedback from you, like I have been getting some feedback on it in Amsterdam and Vienna, hopefully it will get like richer and better, and it will end up being published somewhere. The paper or presentation is called After the Post-Internet and the Winter of AI. And in it, I will be talking about machine intelligence, a little bit about philosophy of history, about the temporality of our current computational paradigm and its limits. And definitely we're going to talk, Trump talk a little bit. And in the context of like his campaign as a form of speculative computation and hacking as algorithm. And then hopefully if there's time, we can get back to art and what art can do, because we only have half an hour. So I'll start with the abstract. Viewed from the inside of contemporary time and space, the internet paradigm, the network discourses, and our dominant computational logic appears as a series of sensible theories and philosophies that model intelligence and the working of the cognitive, social, and natural systems based on the mechanisms of computational hardware, software, and processes. But viewed from the outside of this particular contemporaneity, computationalism is a specific worldview and a distinct cultural logic belonging to our particular time and space, one that perhaps is already reaching or will soon reach its peak. Many experts from the fields of machine intelligence and philosophy of technology agree that a sudden decline in research, development, and enthusiasm about high technology is inevitable, given the fundamental limitations of both our knowledge of the mechanisms of the species of brain and the concepts and materials supporting our existing computational infrastructure. So because of these two limitations of how little we know about what is thought and how thoughts are formed in living systems, which has to do with our understanding of biology, but then our limitations of machines, these things that we've created. There's a widespread belief that technological progress within the next decade will witness a setback, while new advancements will greatly slow down, if not altogether come to a halt. Then there is the political reality of our technologies, which historically have placed most, if not all, of their developments amongst the arsenal of the rich and the powerful, those to whom Marxists refer to as the owners of the means of production. What happens in the near future, when technological progress and the emergence of artificial intelligence is politically subsumed, evolutionarily decelerated, and culturally forgotten? How can we chart a way in which culture and art can help to overcome the post-internet and the winter of AI? Or what I would begin to argue in the very first part of what we should actually be calling machine intelligence rather than artificial intelligence. Now, why machine intelligence and not AI? But by calling it AI, we've been neglecting the important facts. One is an ontological fact, and the other one is a historical one. Using the term AI designates and valorizes human or mammal or other life form who possess intelligence over the intelligence which is practiced by our machines, the automated intelligence of the machines. These machines can be, of course, social, political, cultural, scientific, etc. So that's one reason why calling it artificial is kind of like misleading, has been misleading from the beginning. We should always call it machine intelligence rather than artificial intelligence. And the category of AI, by placing the emergence of the so-called artificial intelligence in the future rather than in the past, neglects how so many of our previous or current systems designed through the interaction between human intelligence and the world has already been practicing machine intelligence. And Paul, I think, referred to that as well in his presentation. So, and the fact that also calling it artificial intelligence neglect the fact that machine intelligence is and always will feature at least some degree of human social and collective participation. So by calling it artificial, it kind of like we dream of this sci-fi entity, which is always kind of like autonomous from humans and it's on its own, rather than somehow still connected to these older systems. So what are the impediments, to go back to the main question of the presentation, what are the impediments to the development of further MI or machine intelligence? These impediments are scientific, physical, and most certainly political, mirroring three categories of political economy, technology, and nature, which I will be addressing next. Many people, both on the right and the left, believe in the finality of this last point, the political, the total utilization of technology, that we are moving towards the permanent political hold of the capitalist class over the means of technological production. As if it is possible for political economy to completely control the fate of technology. So to make sense of this and give you guys a close look as to how I arrive at my position, I want to share with you my own particular philosophy of history. This distinction is important, especially if we want to get out of the three positions of naturalism, Marxist economism, and technological vitalism, without completely rejecting all three and trying to reinvent the wheel. So this is sort of like how I think it's a way to think all these three categories together and still have something as like philosophy of history. Even though technology shares its material and historical substrates with the two categories of nature and political economy, it is possible to rethink techne as having a materialist history of its own. This is along the lines of Paul and the name that Paul brought up, which is Friedrich Kittler, right? This is like a Kittlerian way. The historical trajectory of today's high technology reaches back to the emergence of language and continues on a path towards the future of machine or artificial intelligence. The interrelated histories of nature, political economy, and technology impact each other, but maintain their autonomy in the last instance. The stability of the universe, or nature at large, which contains the small and isolated island called the planet Earth, cannot be taken for granted. Science demonstrates that nature has never stopped evolving. Meanwhile, the evolution of political economy out of natural history does not bind politics to the limitations of nature either. Nor can political economy be claimed to determine a particular destiny for either the future of nature or technology. The limits we set and the horizons we open for our understanding of nature, as well as our social and technological advancement, require the constant reassessment of the changing complexities with which these three entities simultaneously relate or oppose one another. Meanwhile, any major shift in one category can significantly impact the other two without fully subsuming them. The promises and dangers involved in the emergence of machine intelligence or further development of machine intelligence, or what we call artificial intelligence, can only be understood in the context of the trilectics rather than dialectics, the trilectics that technology constellates with nature and political economy. This dynamic history sees these three forces of nature, society, and technology at a kind of a three-sided dialectic. Of course, we can at any given point simplify the three into two, depending on the kind of analysis we would like to have. Kind of like the Marxist analysis itself was a kind of simplification of it into two. But it is good to keep in mind that this reduction always comes at a price that should be worth the analysis that requires that simplification. So we shouldn't just simplify things into two for no reason. So in this regard, we are left with the question, what is capitalism? Or better, what is the power, nature, and technologies of capital in this contemporary moment of technogenesis, which is in this contemporary moment of technological evolution? As Bernard Stiegler put it very eloquently last month in Vancouver, I was in a conversation with him, capitalism is no longer an economic system as perceived by Marx, or as I added to the conversation, it's even larger than what Nitzan and Bichler call a system for the quantification and accumulation of power. For them, for Nitzan and Bichler, capitalism is power. They talk about capital power. So for Stiegler, capitalism has become an episteme, what sets the limits of knowledge, and a new form of epistemology itself, an autonomous way of explaining what do we know and what we know, or a holistic system that sees the world and inscribes a way of seeing onto the world. And we were discussing this last night with some of my friends who have a sort of an interesting transdisciplinary practice here, and they're working on opening up an experimental space that would include art and discourse and all sorts of stuff. That, like, the clock is ticking on, and this is, of course, with conversation with other people like Nick Cernicek and the others, that, like, the clock is ticking on how much time we have before we can actually overturn this. Once this establishes itself, there will be no room to argue for any kind of, like, anything outside of capitalism, because it becomes this, like, becomes almost like third or fourth nature, and it will be impossible to talk outside of it, and you have to always talk inside it or work inside it. And, you know, Trump's victory actually exemplifies this passage to this mode. Like, all of a sudden, this, like, sudden emergence of him is actually about how capitalism is going to become like a form of, like, I don't know, like, nature. The system I'm describing also explains how and why someone like Trump is pulled to the center of political power at this highest level. So for me, capitalism is not the melting pot of different spheres of natural, social, and technological life, like economy, politics, media, art, technology, science, all of our natural resources on the planet Earth. Capitalism is not a vortex that is sucking everything inside itself. The world has not become one big ball of a system, like an extra large power smoothie with pulverized parts unrecognizable. More so, it is that the epistemic limits and logic of capitalism is transplanting itself onto the local conditions of each field and activity, reprogramming them according to its own epistemology to function like capitalist economy, but in their own specific way. So it's more like the metaphor for it would be something like John Carpenter's The Thing, if you have seen it. Or like the remake. Both of them are amazing films. I totally ask you to see them, because they're amazing sci-fi films or horror sci-fi films, but also they'll tell us more about how capitalism works. Meanwhile, as we move up the hierarchy within each field of social activity, they converge into that one thing which is the real capitalist mode of power in its highest and most intense, but also universal level. This is where Obama meets Beyonce, or where Jay-Z dances with Maria Abramovic. This doesn't mean that all of these activities from the bottom of the social hierarchy all the way up are melting into one. Quite contrary, the structure, despite its pyramidal essence, maintains its fractal ontology. We are dealing with many converging pyramids which join to create the big one, that of the universal capitalism schema of power. Like an eternal vacuum, the very top sucks money, power, intellect, creativity, and celebrity power into itself to merge them into one, while at the same time keeping them as the figureheads of the pyramid to which they specifically belong. Meanwhile, from the perspective of the ground, to be a successful player in a field, one needs to fight like a warrior with their peers in order to be granted upward navigation. And as they move higher, they get closer and closer to those from other fields who have also beat the competition in their fields, and they are also ascending. What we are facing in the intensification of the logic of transportation from 99% on the ground to the 1% on the top these days is a slow narrowing of the pyramid. A large majority of social actors, what we usually call like middle class or middle people, have historically been suspended in the middle of the pyramid between the top and the ground, functioning like a filter in the upward transfer of lucky actors, let's just put it that way. But the pyramid is narrowing and slowly disappearing, actually. What we are rapidly moving towards having a large base and a very narrow top with not many stratas in between. The future shape of the social power structure is a former pyramid with its head cut off and flying further into the space, and the rest of its body collapsing on the ground, causing the intensification of competition on the ground and ever new and inventive ways of reaching or hacking into this flying mantle that's now sort of like independent and on its own. Now hold this thought and let's go back to the after post-internet and the winter of machine intelligence for a sec. Maybe then the above explanation would make more sense. We said the limits to machine intelligence are part physical, part scientific, and part political. Given the time limit of this event, I would like to focus briefly on these, the physical and the scientific limits, and then return to the question of politics and maybe like talk a little bit more about that one. The physical limits have to do with the scarcity of resources. Technology runs on materials, from rare earth minerals to lithium to the energy needed to run machines. Even though moving towards an artificial intelligence of coordinating resources, we might end up saving a lot of energy and resources, but still, until we get there, we need these resources. The physical limits are also limits of how fast machines can process and how much processing power are at the disposal of an agent in order to produce a thought or an instance of cognition. These material needs are shifting the priorities of our tech companies engaged in machine intelligence research to refocus and become something else, like how Amazon became a server company, or how Google's getting into energy because they need that, and Google might end up becoming like an energy company in 15 years. Machine intelligence, or the ability of machines to run complex cognitive processes such as perception, recognition, reasoning, and control, have captured the public imagination for over 60 years. However, artificial intelligence research is reaching limits that has to do with our limited understanding of what is thought and what constitutes cognition, as well as how these concepts can be realistically programmed and initiated and be expected from non-mammal or non-living entities. Despite significant progress in machine learning over the past few years, today's state-of-the-art algorithms are brittle and do not generalize well. In contrast, the brain is able to robustly separate and categorize signals in the presence of significant noise and non-linear transformations. It can extrapolate from single examples to entire class of stimuli. It can actually take something out of noise, and we're going to get to that hopefully if there's time when we're talking about Trump's election, and turn that into a pattern all by itself. The scientific limits has to do with the correlation between what we know of the working of the living mind and our ability to simulate it in dead matter and call it technology. The mainstream phenomenology of the early 20th century is what has given us computers. I'm sure a lot of you are aware of the fact that Husserl's phenomenology and then Bergson's reading of Husserl and being inspired by him and doing his own type of phenomenology and temporality had a lot to do with how Norbert Wiener and those guys thought about temporality of computation. Actually, in Norbert Wiener's first book called Cybernetic, the first chapter, he compares what he calls like astrology with the science of weather, and he talks about how cybernetics is about movement from the Newtonian time into Bergsonian time. And I'm going to explain that a little bit because I think it's important to sort of like get to the philosophical or like conceptual limit of computation. And since temporality is at the heart of the question of thinking, one must understand the parallels between our limited understanding of time and how this is mirrored in a way time is handled by our machines. These scientific limits, as they turn out, have their roots not just in math and psychology, but in philosophy. Why do we think of artificial intelligence as a simulation of human processes, or even those of mammals, or even animals and plants? Can we ever think of an even more general concept of cognition and intelligence that is applicable to life forms alien to our understanding of life, or to non-life forms at all? Our machine intelligence experts and philosophers alike have not fared well in thinking speculatively about machine intelligence, because it's always in relation to like some other form of intelligence. It's never sort of like an intelligence that kind of emerges out of like with a complete different logic and a complete different temporality. It has nothing to do with the way we historically have understood time. And even though our understanding of time has changed and we've updated it, but still it has this limit that comes from how we historically have understood what it means to experience time. So in Husserlian language, we have what he called retention and protention, are the key aspects of phenomenology of temporality and the process of presenting, which means making the present active. In a way, Heidegger's philosophical project was how it is possible to hijack this process for rewinding time. According to Husserl, perception has three temporal aspects: retention, the immediate present or presencing, and protention, and a flow through which each moment of protention becomes retention of the next. So for Husserl, these three kind of like three wheels, right? One sort of like takes the present and make it a memory and then access that memory and brings it to the present. And one is one that thinks about the future and make the future into present and then saves it if it's important and brings it up later. It's like the easiest thing is like you're looking at this bottle and you go like, oh, beautiful green color. Oh, I need to buy a sweater for my grandmother. She likes this green, light green color. I got to remember to buy her a gift for her birthday. And how sort of like passed on the what we know and what we have to do, kind of like our presence, and then saved or like decisions are made towards how we're going to move to the future. So our experience of the world, according to Husserl, is not a series of unconnected moments. Indeed, it would be impossible to have, I think this is a quote by him on my paper, is like, I think I'm just actually reading you Husserl for the next two sentences. Mm-hmm. Our experience of the world is not of a series of unconnected moments. Indeed, it would be impossible to have an experience of the world if we did not have a sense of temporality, that our perception brings an impression to our mind depending upon retention and protension. So what I'm arguing is that computation as we know it, our current computational paradigm, depends a lot on this Husserlian retention. Retention, back to Husserl, is the process whereas a phase of a perceptual act is retained in our consciousness. It is a presentation of that which is no longer before us and is distinct from the immediate experience. A simple example might be that of watching a ball being thrown. We retain where the ball was in our mind to understand the momentum of the ball as we perceive it in the immediate present. Retention is not a representation of memory, but a presentation of a temporally extended present. That is, a present that extends beyond the few short milliseconds era, sort of like to the past and to the past and then to the future, or to the future and then to the past. Protension is our anticipation of the next moment, the moment that has yet to be perceived. Again, using the example of a ball, our focus shifts along the expected path the ball will take. So, quote close. So, our machines, in my opinion, and a lot of people who study these things, philosophers of technology, are modeled on Husserlian temporality in a way that they are heavily favored by retention, and potential can only exist based on what already has been retained. This sort of like basically has been like obsession of my friend and colleague, Reza Nagarestani, the Iranian philosopher. And he's been kind of like dealing with this from the moment he kind of like came to America from Asia and gave that the paper in Miguel Abreu Gallery, which was all about like this problem of current mode of computation. Our current computational paradigm has a shell life shorter than a quarter century. Our data-based machines are modeled on empiricism, are too positivistic in practice. They know how to process and understand recorded information. Data is dead, but do not know, our machines do not know how to encounter the world prior to its datafication. So the world has to become data and then our machines can deal with it. So the difference here is between reading, understanding, and also interpreting. That's another way. And how sort of like the urge to want to understand sort of like arrives prior to even data coming to you. So you have this anxiety or desire to understand, and that is sort of like human intelligence sort of like have that prior to even information is, even you can say animals have that. So we have created the first set of machines that read. We are in the process of creating second, which are machines that understand, and understand really well. But the move to create the third group, which is machines that have this desire and can kind of interpret and are expecting interpretation even prior to data, right, is still like we're still behind. And this is sort of like the limit that I'm talking about in terms of like the winter. The winter happens when we have these perfect machines that can totally handle tons of data, tons of information coming from multiple sources, there's enough processing power, but they still lack that desire to take it somewhere or desire to interpret it or desire to do something with it that the thinking subject has to have or the collective subjects have before they even act on information. We map out every object once we connect every person 24/7 to the networks, once we figure out ways to monetize these transactions and pay down the control grid to run this machine smoothly, regardless of its natural and geopolitical costs, we will reach the limits of the current computational paradigm and the winter begins. So that's sort of like, we're still 10, 15, or 20 years away from this winter, because still, as you notice, data speed goes up and down. We can't even like have like 24-hour internet everywhere. You go to the basement, you don't have internet. You know, once all these limits are taken, once internet of thing is like bulletproof and no one can hack it, and every object is transmitting data and everything is connected and mapped out, that's it. That's the beginning of the winter. And of course, the winter also has a cultural cost. Once that winter comes, and I think I'm going to explain it, so I better just like read, because time is limited, right? But I'm not sure if I have it, but I just want to say that the interest that the art and culture in general have in computation will go away, because technology becomes second nature or goes to the background. It becomes like when the fridges and the televisions first came, my grandmother was like wigging out. It was so exciting. Life was so exciting. But then after 5 years, televisions and refrigerators stop like evolving, so they just become a tool you use, and they kind of go to the background, and then it's like, okay, now what? So that's what happens. If we don't break through this limit, and who breaks through this limit, at what political cost, and what for what political project, then we're going to be left behind, or like stop, computation will stop to evolve. And so basically, like Stigler talks about it is like tertiary retention, right? Which is like computation as a form of tertiary retention, right? Or part of the tertiary retention being like the memory of the body through the genes, and then memory of your own memory in your brain, and then the prosthetic memory, which is the memory of outside, right? And how these three kind of like work together to continue on our life and the life of the culture. That's like Stigler's way of sort of like putting sort of like what is the ontology of technology. And I think going through this breaking through the winter means that we have to come up with a new way of thinking about all this. This tertiary retention, it's all of this is sort of like kind of like coming to a halt, or like stops evolving. It's not going to stop forever, but it's going to stop. Now, if politics is the autonomous conditioner of the social atmosphere in which these other autonomous activities take place, the other autonomous activities being like the natural world kind of like evolving on its own, and then our understanding or scientific or the conceptual part kind of like the way I explained it evolve on its own autonomously but kind of related. So in the context of this, a new trend is emerging. Those who, for whatever reason and through whatever means, have managed to pull themselves higher begin having a different relationship with the world, and particularly with technology, with communication technology, than the ones at the very bottom. For those who are in the higher stratas, technology becomes more like a toy. It's an option, like any other option in the real world, because they have secured themselves a permanent place in the material world, in the pyramid of their field. They have a good job, they have a good investment, and therefore intense and invasive technologies are now a hassle to their life. It becomes something that you have to use in order to maintain your position, rather than something to use because it helps you, all these utopian notions of technology. For the rest, who have not secured a permanent place, who do not own a home, who live paycheck by paycheck, and are still trying to find a break, this like the space of communication technology and social media, like the examples we saw prior to this, is the only space of competition and navigation at the bottom of the social field. And sort of like this intelligence, this new form of intelligence that tries to hack from this 99 world, somehow hack it to the higher levels, because as we talked about, the traditional pyramid is kind of falling apart, and you have to find ways to go from the bottom to somewhere in the top. So if their online activities are surging right now, it's because their real life isn't really going anywhere. The social space of the digital becomes the track and field of those who have no other space to compete and proliferate. This new class struggle makes the space available for competition smaller, whether they're cyber or other spaces. It makes it clear that they are not open for everyone to compete in. They become intense and violent because there are too many people. The space of social media and technology, the space of data and algorithm, is really the space of low intensity war. If you consider all human activity as culture, at the level of culture, not at the level of utility, of course, science, art, politics, economy, these are all different operational modes in society. The inner pyramidal wars, or in this inner pyramidal wars, war become a feature of the new class system we described in the beginning. War becomes no longer a metaphor, but an actual everyday practice. There's a growing war in every aspect of human life. War no longer will be a metaphor for describing human activity in other fields other than military. If you think of it that way, then you can begin to understand military war from this perspective of the digital class struggle from the ground up. And if you do that, you're already in a war yourself. The war we are talking about, the war that's being fought, is that of those without secure physical presence, without permanent institutional jobs and security, are using the space of technology as a battleground to gain traction on the material world or create an alternative universe with its own affordances that can compete or even surpass the material world. What's happening now, at this point that we are in, what's happening is that those with traction in the physical world want to ensure that the competition of lower classes in the technological fields pertaining to power is not too much. So the technology becomes black boxed and regulated. And then the fear of surveillance is over-exaggerated. The cops keeping an eye. Cops are actually watching, but the idea that cops are watching itself becomes like larger than actual how much surveillance is going on. Cops cannot keep an eye only for capitalists and not for everybody else. This way, you can compete and become Beyonce. You can compete and become somebody. It's just to stop you from any kind of other uses that they don't deem necessary for you to do. That's the purpose of black boxing. Any kind of watch, they watch you and monitor you. And this is one way that you get scared out of using the internet. And this is why I like how Paul ended his talk by like more participation is actually more sort of like more new inventive and encrypted or not ways of participating is actually a way of addressing this rather than getting scared and pulling out, which is the end of my paper kind of is about. The fear of surveillance slows down participation and enhancement of technology through participation. There is no machine intelligence without humans, as we discussed. So, and if this is the case, then our participation in this struggle not only benefits our life, but enhances the emergence of a better machine intelligence. But the reality of surveillance creates the attitude of, fuck it, I don't want to use it, cops are watching me. But in this context, you're entering an era where there is going to be a movement among lower classes of society to discourage the use of technology. That is just trouble, or it's just it'll get cops to your door, or it just gets you in more trouble than you necessarily need. Then the emerging culture of middle to rich people is highly anti-technology already. Story after story tells us how technology is detrimental for the development of children, how it interrupts our normal cognitive capabilities, how it isolates us and causes autism on both individual and on the social level. So if you look around, soon you will notice that rich people are actually not on their phones as much anymore. The rich are not posting to Facebook, will not be posting to Facebook and other social media all the time. So in order to look rich, you have to pull yourself out of the internet so you can actually say, look, I can afford not to be entangled online. I can afford not to let police see my stuff. I can afford other means of communication, and I have the material basis to afford this refusal. So these are what I'm forecasting. And then there is going to be this huge new trend, like fashion or culture trend, that to be cool would be equated to not be on technology. To be cool is to be in real life. Government would promote this because they want to keep the powers of technology to themselves. They want to be either one who wins the war all the time, the war that they want. They want it to be in the war that they want, not your own war, not your own defensive war. They want you to participate in their offensive war. So this space will be slowly closed off by these capital and governmental and media, mass media, or like what they call like mainstream media sources. The government will encourage this trend among poor people. They love the idea of not being on technology because it allows them to get away with whatever they want to do. As data collection is outsourced to objects and retire little or no human, and the idea of human being involved is retired, and there's no need for human participation, we will see technology slipping to the background. And this is where the metaphor of Truman Show actually is sort of like I use it in a paper, because in the Truman Show, that's really what it is. The technology has been pushed to the behind this seemingly natural surface, and that's the kind of, if there's a nightmare scenario for me, that's much more nightmarish than Trump, is a world in which surveillance technologies are no more in your face. So even though you withdraw from technology and you're not using your phone, but somehow everything you do is being like, so basically you're living in a total technosphere, but you think that you're having your organic coffee and nobody's watching you, and the power to be lets you have that mental space. But actually everything you pull is plastic, and underneath it is 10 sensors that are like watching you even better than before. But they're giving you the space of mind, so you think you're like in your lovely organic, like, you know, like, I don't know, world, but you're not. We will see technology slipping to the background. What you end up having is all the mechanisms of control and measurement of whatever you be doing and whatever you saying in order to either monitor or market things to you or to create perception for you that it is as close as possible to reality, to the pre-internet reality. All that stuff right now is in our face, but they're gonna go to the background. We see it, it's camera, it's this and that. All of it becomes hidden and camouflaged into the material world. So you get this feeling that you're going back into nature. But all the nature, when you go back, there has been a microphone there. There's a camera there. This is actually not real. It's plastic and it's a technological product that makes it look like this. The deception becomes camouflaged back into the natural world. It's taken for granted, it becomes taken for granted, basically. You just get over it. The question of its abilities don't get multiplied the way the powers want it. A government that in any other instance of life tries to control the population or people without power and money, tries to prevent them from doing things, takes away their rights, takes away their power to control their destiny, all of a sudden will let you use their technology and get to artificial intelligence. I mean, this is like really like a too much of a positive thinking. Why would they? This is the political limit. Why would they want us to evolve this out of this statistical computation? They have no interest for us to push this beyond this, because this is the perfect amount of technology that powers that be think they need in order to run the world. No pretension, no sort of like future-oriented type of artificial intelligence or machine intelligence in which these desires of the future that are going to help us figure out the present. All we need is just collect the data, and who's going to control it will be in charge of the material world. Maybe, I don't know how many minutes I've been speaking, but I don't know how long that's been, because there's a couple of things that are not in the text that I would like to bring up, but I don't want to take up too much time. We have 3 minutes. Okay, good. So yeah, So the couple of interesting thing about the Trump elections that I think are pertinent, and I think this was really like the failure of Clinton campaign, and I mean I'm not talking about like Clinton's policy or Trump's policies here, their character quality or like who was a better candidate. We all know answer to those, but just dealing with them in terms of like as two sets of different methods of using technology or two different technological processes themselves, the Trump campaign was actually exercising this type of speculative technology way more than the Clinton campaign. Clinton campaign was totally a statistical computation, totally based on data collected and sort of like, oh, projections of these polls and how these polls are telling you what to do, rather than sort of like being creative with noise and trying to like see what they can pull out of the noise, right? And this is sort of like, I have to get back to this categorization of Lev Manovich, because I think it's very important. Actually, this is something that Matteo Pasquinelli kind of like pointed out to me, and I went and read it by Lev Manovich, and it's in, Lev talked about this like years ago, but then Matteo just brought it up, and using this, philosophy of technology, Alan Feldman, I kind of like, I think I'm adding a fourth layer to it, is like for Lev and also for Matteo, basically, that on the lowest level, you have people who don't have access to technology, the ones that Facebook wants to give this like amazing ability, and their life are subject to data collection. The movement will be seen and collected, but they don't actually have internet access themselves. Drones are kind of like looking at them. Think of like people who get accused of terrorism and killed, right or wrong, right? And then the second layer of people for left are people who have internet and can access data, but they don't own or have access to high-powered algorithms. So they can deal with a lot of data. They can pull up a web page or post something to their Facebook, but they can kind of like look at trends of data or like see how things work in a larger scale. And then the third layer are people who actually have powerful algorithms and can run like powerful stuff and kind of like have a larger scale view of things because these processes give them that views. And then the fourth layer in my mind are those who have actual physical power in the real world, like militaries, governments, businesses, who actually can put these information or what they've taken our information into action and actually change reality, create new reality. This is not about creating propaganda online. This is about creating new material facts on the ground that then would become data after they've created it. So this is a type of speculative sort of like use of technology that at this fourth level you have access to and you can do. And none of us have that. US government has it, or like some large corporation has it, right? So like for instance, to go back to the to Trump campaign, some of you must have read that Bloomberg story, right? There was like two important things that like is being like not talked about a lot. First thing is that the minute Bannon, this alt-right guy, got in charge of the campaign, one thing that they did was they kind of like told their online young white supremacist buddies to lie to the pollsters and tell them that they're going to vote for Clinton. And then they told them to tell other families and friends that they're voting for Clinton to corrupt the Clinton camp's data, to give them false hope, to give them, I mean, as much as they could, not that they could corrupt all the data, but even this little bit of online chatter about not voting for Trump and voting for Clinton would create this air of success already. And we all know how much Clinton campaign suffered from this air, right? And then the second thing, which wasn't a Bloomberg story, and you can look it up, was that when this guy came and a new approach was sort of like adopted, which was sort of like based on all the like forecasts, Trump was gonna lose. It was obvious. So his data team, people who were dealing with his like algorithmic sort of like campaign, decided that like we have nothing to lose. So why can't we just go to the noise that was not being collected and become patterned and see if there's anything there that we can play with. And then they sort of like saw this category of voters, which is like rural, rust belt, blah, blah, blah. And they thought, oh, this is an interesting group. Nobody's like really paying attention to them. What if we kind of like do something with these people? And then they started running simulation in which this group of people is actually active and become a trigger to come and play a role in the election. And all of a sudden, their model started responding positively. That's when they asked Trump to put a lot of ads and emphasis on this group. And totally, this was one of the reasons why they were able to basically create a new set of patterns just out of something that was not necessarily like seen by the regular pollsters and kind of surprise everyone by. So these are the types of limit that unfortunately the bad people are exercising much more and much stronger than good people. That we really like. So when we're thinking about like breaking this barrier, it's not necessarily a bad thing to come up with better artificial intelligence or machine intelligence. It's about like who's gonna get there first, who's gonna do it for what purpose first, and how this is gonna get utilized in a larger sort of like scale. And I think I talked enough, and maybe we should just like start a panel or something. And all you guys online watching, thank you very much.